Namaste. Welcome to the Festival of Bharat. My name is Kamal Madi Shetty, and you're tuned into season 4 of the Festival of Bharat. The guest we have with us today is the well-known author Shantanu Gupta ji. Shantanu ji was born in Bareilly in Uttar Pradesh and received his education in Xavier's Institute and University of Sussex. He is an author of several books, such as India's Football Dreams, Uttar Pradesh Vikas Ki Pratiksha Mein, and the two of his recent books, which we are going to talk about, and that is The Monk Who Became Chief Minister and Bharatiya Janata Party, Past, Present and Future. Dear viewers, it's my pleasure to welcome Shantanu ji. Namaste, Shantanu ji, and welcome to the Festival of Bharat.
Namaskar, Kamal ji. It's lovely to be back on your platform, though in online format this time. Yeah, thank you. Thank you for having me.
Thank you, Shantanu ji, for joining us. I want to begin by asking you about Yogi Adityanath ji's early life. You know, can you tell us about what was the family he was born into? How was his childhood and early adulthood like?
Yeah, so Kamal, you told about my most famous book, The Monk Who Became Chief Minister. It's a definitive biography of UP Chief Minister Yogi Adityanath, right? And you know, very interesting, I started the book chronologically, like any biography is, like from the bachpan, from the childhood to his college days, then he became a Mahant, and then he became a member of parliament, and then he became a chief minister. But during my extensive research, I went to Uttarakhand, went almost like he has 4 brothers, 3 sisters, father at that time, fortunately father was also alive. He died a couple of months back. So I met almost everyone, but there was nothing much available about him. So, you know, what I did, I reversed the whole book. And I started the book with the oath of Yogi Adityanath as a chief minister and then moved backward and then covered his childhood. But whatever I was able to gather from Uttarakhand is the following, right? So he is born in Uttarakhand. As he told, he was one of the boys among the seven siblings, 4 sons and 5 daughters. And if you see a lot of his working style, what he focuses on has a lot of reflection back to his childhood days. So let's say his mother used to get up at 4 o'clock. They have cows. They used to love the cows, rear them. They have a small field. Father used to work in forest, was a forest officer. They moved multiple divisions, right? And Uttarakhand, you know, is a Devbhumi, very religious place. A lot of Swatantra Senani, a lot of freedom fighter comes from there. He's born and brought up in such kind of environment. A very honest forest officer, a very hardworking woman as a mother, 7 siblings, cows at home, small field, moving from one place to another place in Uttarakhand. Uttarakhand being a Devbhumi, a religious place. So I think that's which you can reflect, you can see in how he's operating today. And then he moved to multiple schools. He's in Rishikesh, then went to Kotdwar, did his BSc graduation. And during graduation, he joined Akhil Bharatiya Vidyarthi Parishad. Right. And that's also a very interesting story. In fact, he first joined SFI, the left wing student union, like by fluke. Fluke means like someone took him to union. He wanted to join some student politics. And that time he didn't know the nuances between various other student outfits or different parties. So he joined SFI. And then within a few days, he realized this is not my cup of tea. These are not the ideas I endorse. And then he moved to Vidyarthi Parishad. Right. And what all kind of things he did. He was a good orator. His school teachers still remember them, how good orator he was, right? His school teachers still remember them. If someone in 11th or 12th grade choose a gutka or start smoking like a BD or a cigarette, how he goes and complains, right? You call it a moral policing of today, what he's doing, or how such sane habits were part of his bringing up from that time, right? So this is his childhood, which is interesting. And the inflection point is that when Mahant Avedanath, his guru, during the Ram Mandir Yatra, comes to Uttarakhand to his college and he meets him, and both get a very instant bond of a guru-shishya relationship. And Guru Avedanath, after a couple of visits, told him that you are destined to be in Goraknath Mutt, and why don't you come? And then they met multiple times, and finally, one day in 1994, he left his house without informing his parents that he's going to become a sannyas. He said, I'm going to do a job. And through a newspaper cutting, his father, Mr. Anand Singh Best, who is no more now, got to know that my son, Ajay Mohan Singh Best, now Yogi Aditya, has become a sannyasi, and then they went to Gorakhpur, and then the whole life unfolded the way we know today. So that's his bachpan to youth, childhood to youth in a nutshell.
Very fascinating, Shantanuji. Thank you for sharing that. If we look at, you know, we fast forward to the present and we look at, especially the time around when he, you know, became chief minister, a lot of people in the media, be it the Indian media or the foreign media, they tried to build a kind of narrative around Yogiji. You know, and one wonders how far from truth is that? So I wanted to ask you, do you think there has been a deliberate sort of an attempt to malign his image in many ways?
In fact, very interestingly, that was also one of my starting point of writing this biography, because when I asked my team to give me all the articles available on him in Indian media, English, Hindi, everyone, right? And largely English media articles are 99.9% negative on him. I think I imagine a member of parliament who's a 5-time member of parliament, Lok Sabha member of parliament, won through exponential margin, even when BJP was not doing good in 2004 and 2009, even when he's winning, how come everything can be negative about him, right? And that started my research. And then I realized, I wrote an article recently in Op-Ed, Op India, that how Advani, anti-Advanism was an industry at some point, then anti-Modism became an industry, and that now people have started writing their CV as anti-Yogism, right? So I think that's a full-time career for a lot of people, and that's the flourish. And a lot of these people, and I keep naming them particularly and keep calling their farce in their articles, from New York Times to Washington Post to Indian ones, right? That let alone Lucknow, a lot of them have not even traveled to Delhi ever, right? And they have these fancy stories they get from here and there, almost like a WhatsApp or a Facebook post, and then they build a whole story out of it. So I think, yeah, it's an industry. Now, Yogi Aditya is a new hate boy. Earlier, Narendra Modi was a hate boy. Now he has become a different position. It's just an industry for them. It's just a career for a lot of people. And I think in a democracy, vote tells how people like or love him. So I think, yeah, that's a media bias. I think that bias, Kamal, is not on him, more of on his saffron robe, right? Narendra Modi is somehow digested, but this person, like, he's adorning what he is, right? That's not very comfortable for a lot of people.
Yeah, absolutely. I think there is a lot of saffron phobia in the way he's portrayed, and we can clearly see that. Shantanuji, you know, moving very logically from what you said, there are so many of our, you know, Muslim brothers and sisters who support Yogiji, right? But this is never discussed, be it in the media or otherwise. So can you tell us about this relationship between Yogi Adityanath ji and the Muslim community, especially in his constituency, but also otherwise?
In fact, Kamal, I'm just coming from a News 18 debate where they were talking about some Muslim element, Wasi fighting election in West Bengal. And my point is always, like, why we want to keep communities, want to look communities separately. Why a leader has to cater to Hindus or to Jains or to Brahmins or to Kshatriyas, to Hindus and Muslims, the people of India, people of India. Right, with Narendra Modi is telling from last 6-7 years, right? Sabka saath, sabka vikas. If I make a road, I will not charge a toll based on your religion or caste, right? I will not ask your caste certificate. If I deliver homes, if I deliver gas ka chula, if I deliver toilets, if I deliver neem coated urea, it'll be for everyone. So I think I can bring you a couple of instances during my research which I have encountered. So he used to do a Janta Darbar even when he was not a chief minister. From last 2 decades, he's running a Janta Darbar. And I've attended Janta Darbars before he was a CM and even after when he became a CM. And you will visibly can see a lot of Muslim people accessing him for help, right? And what is help for their scholarship, the typical government help. And this help they're seeking when Mulayam Singh Yadav was the chief minister, when Mayawati was the chief minister, when Akhilesh Yadav was the chief minister, right? And similar set of people now you can find in Lucknow. In Lucknow, after being a chief minister, he's running the same Janta Darbar again, right? One of his colleges, his dean, the head person is a Muslim guy. The chief contractor of the Mutt is a Muslim guy. Whenever there's a Khichdi Bhoj, Saman Khichdi Bhoj happens in Mutt, which is a very common practice there, when people of all castes come together, you'll find Muslim people having Khichdi and Dahi there. It's a normal practice. A lot of the shops, you know, every temple have a religious shops outside, right? Almost half of the shops are owned by Muslim owners, right? So I'm thinking, but again, a special kind of narrative is built around based on one or two videos which he has stored in a particular scenario when his complaint was not getting registered in the police station because it's a Mulayam Singh was the chief minister or Mayawati was the chief minister. I think a lot of people tried hard to portray his whole image based on those one or two speeches told for a particular purpose in an electorally charged environment.
Absolutely, Shantanuji. You know, it has been close to 4 years that he has been chief minister. And I wanted to actually turn to governance under Yogiji. And we will, of course, come to some specific areas in just a bit. But I wanted to ask you, what have been some of the major developments in terms of governance in these 4 years that you see?
So you're right. In March, he took the oath in March 3rd week. And this March, he will be completing 4 years. And this will be kind of the election year. Last year is called the election year, right? And this 4 years for anyone who has lived, followed Uttar Pradesh, right, as a citizen or as an analyst, they can tell that there's a sea change. There's a sea change. What Uttar Pradesh has seen in the last 15 years of Mulayam Singh Yadav, Mayawati, and Akhilesh Yadav rule is a sea change. So first 6 months started, Kamal, with hygiene, right? Like come to offices 9 o'clock. I'll tell you a basic example. Like it seems a lot of officers tell me with the oath of privacy that I'll not reveal. So I'll not name. They say the first call from Akhilesh Yadav's office used to come at 12 o'clock, 2 o'clock types, right? And the first call from Yogi Adityanath's office had come at 7:13, 8 o'clock in the morning, right? So that tells you a sea difference of a discipline. I'll tell you one more very interesting example. So, you know, a cabinet meeting, right? Every chief minister has a cabinet, which has a cabinet minister and the secretary is involved. So the cabinet note used to go to the house of every cabinet minister and get signed in Akhilesh Yadav's time, right? Because cabinet note has to be signed, right? But in Yogi Adityanath's time, every cabinet meeting goes on for at least 1.5-2 hours, and there's argument, counter-argument, things are settled, and then only things are passed, right? That's how serious or non-serious the governance was then, and that's how serious the governance is now. Taking a few very prominent thing which is helping UP to bring back its prosperity, because that's more important. Until another state is not prosperous, that will lead to law and order issues, that will lead to poverty generally, right? And the more dependence on government also, right? So prosperity needs roads, amazing network of roads. Akhilesh Yadav till today keeps singing about one road that he has built, right? Similarly, like 5-6 projects are going on, and some of them will be completed before the election, some of them are already completed. Purvanchal Expressway, Bundelkhand Expressway, these are the expressway, but again small roads. So roads network is getting amazingly solid. Coming to power, electricity, for running a prosperous state, you need electricity, right? Now Uttar Pradesh is becoming a power surplus or power neutral state. Uttar Pradesh in Mayawati's and Akhilesh's time was run on it was called a power roaster. Roaster means kahan batti aayegi, kahan batti kategi, where the electricity will come and where the electricity will be cut. And where the electricity will come will depend on the constituencies of the senior leaders. Right? That was the only management was done, right? Where in which festival electricity will come, which festival electricity will not come. Now, every unit, be it a town, be it an urban area, be it a district headquarter, or be it a village, getting 6 to 8 hours of extra more electricity. So what electricity, let's say a village was getting 14 hours of electricity, now it's getting 18 to 20 hours of electricity. A district headquarters is getting 18 hours of electricity, now getting 22 to 24 hours of electricity. And urban headquarters, 24 hours of electricity. And you know what is the check? Go to any industrial area, and they will tell how their diesel gensets bills have come down drastically, right? Because diesel genset bills are only required when there's no electricity, right? And that's a perfect way to measure. And I have done this random checking with various industries, right? So power is coming superbly well. Now coming to welfare schemes, all the welfare schemes of central government, right, are amazingly implemented in UP. Be it the gas vitran, the gas stove and gas cylinder vitran, be it the toilet scheme, be it the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, all of them, right? What UP has done, extension of Narendra Modi's idea of one nation, one card, means one ration card, right? In Uttar Pradesh, the ration cards were not Aadhaar seated, right? And without Aadhaar seating, there's a lot of theft of grain. The ration shop owner was a Malik. He used to give money. He used to give ration. He used to not give ration. He used to announce that ration has come. He used to not announce. And now sitting today in just 3.5 years, all the 22 crore people, ration holders, got Aadhaar verified, and 97 to 98% transaction as we are sitting today are happening through Aadhaar, right? Government of UP saving almost 1,000 to 1,200 crores every month in, which was lost in theft, grain theft earlier, right? Now the SMS should come, and sitting in Lucknow, Yogi Adityanath can see which person have taken how much grains and which kind of grains and on which date, and which Kotedar is the work for the ration shop owner, which Kotedar got which much, how much ration on which date. And all of those 80,000 shop has a POS machine, which is like superbly managed, right? And this, Kamal, helped immensely in the COVID time, right? In COVID time, there are two problems. One is the ration, second is the job. Job, I'll come to how in Manrega, they very smartly managed that, how Manrega job cards have increased tremendously in the COVID time. And second, how the ration will be delivered, because they had this this Aadhaar seeding. That's why the UP government is able to manage even COVID brilliantly, right? So I'm saying very many stories. You asked me some generic ones, so I told you top of my head. But again, if you ask me specifically, I can tell you various other sectors that UP has gained into.
Right. Thanks a lot, Shantanu ji. I think that was a very comprehensive summary. I actually wanted to ask you, you mentioned how the system of providing ration has been made efficient. And that, like you said, has really helped in the way Uttar Pradesh has responded to COVID-19 pandemic. So can you tell us about this COVID-19 response in UP? How has that come about?
So you see, COVID-19, Kamal, was new for everyone. No one knew what has to be done, right? So all the early lockdowns, very strictly, in very disciplined fashion, came in UP. Contact tracing, very meticulous contact tracing started in UP. And how, when Delhi government, Kejriwal Delhi government, pushed their all workers out and the border of Delhi, how Yogi Adityanath came himself, stood there and made sure the massive number of buses are arranged of UP roadways, and people are went to, largely they're from East UP. The send back, he monitored this. Right. And why I'm mentioning this, because coming to Noida and Ghaziabad was a taboo for Mayawati and Akhilesh. It seems whichever CMs come to Noida, he doesn't get elected again. Right. They're just living in that world. Right. And then how he made this team 11. So Yogi has something called Team 11, where there are people, secretaries and ministers, both. We have the people from law and order, people from health, people from ration, people from various walks of UP administration. They sit almost every day, and Yogi Adityanath makes sure that he follows up with all 11 of them before sleeping every day from last 10 months, right? So that's why, how when they came back from Mumbai, they came back from Ahmedabad, they came back from Delhi, through Manrega and other schemes, they were given jobs on priority basis. And how ration, because now they're one card, one ration system, how ration was initially delivered at their doorstep for 3-4 months, and then from the ration shop in very meticulous, in fact, the extra quantity now because of the pandemic, because they're not able to earn, right? So again, all the 3-4 sites managed beautifully. And again, the normal administration is anyway going good. All the companies who are making their mind to shift from China because of COVID, they were invited, almost pulled to Uttar Pradesh, Noida area. Right? In this time only, Yogi Adityanath made the plan that Film City should be brought to India, to UP, right? And he traveled to Mumbai, convinced people, and now they're making a huge Film City in Greater Noida area, right? So all the industrial work, which there's opportunity, which were there during COVID time, those were grabbed, and the people are also taken care of. Right. And that's why UP has the lowest number, based on the population density, the lowest number of positive cases and lowest number of casualties also.
Thanks, Shantanuji. I think that's very fascinating. And on various fronts, I think the response is something that is really noteworthy. I want to come to one particular area of governance, which holds a lot of importance to UP, and that is law and order. Now, this is something that, past governments, we've seen how badly they have handled. And law and order in general in UP is very challenging. So I wanted to understand from you, how has law and order been tackled by the Yogi Adityanath government in the last 4 years?
See, Kamal, you're right. UP is a very populous state, 22 crore people as per census, and there are law and order problems for sure, right? Because the way it's handled in the last 15 years, that has become a practice, right? So what Yogi government has done, starting from the hygiene issue to the more advanced issue. So hygiene issue, and you'll be shocked to hear this, from last 15 years, UP police is working on half capacity. Meaning there are 3 lakh vacant position, only 1.5 lakh were filled. So in last 15 years, UP government is only dealing with half of the police force, only 1.5 lakh police force, when the allocated standard 3 lakh. Why? Because in Mayawati government, a certain caste, certain religion people will get into, someone go to the high court, they will get a stay, and the whole vacancy recruitment will be annulled. In Akhilesh other time, maybe a lot of Yadav people got preference, someone goes to the court, the whole recruitment process annulled. Yogi Adityanath government fought each and every case, closed it, got the recruitment done in a very fair manner, so not there is a single iota of doubt. And now you'll be happy to hear that those 1.5 lakh police fellows are recruited, trained, and now on the field. Right? That itself makes a lot of difference. See, UP mein kaha jata hai, Hindi mein, police ki vardi ka ek baal hai. So if you're wearing the police dress and you're standing on the road, that itself is half of the battle won, right? And then the Romeo Squad. A lot of people make fun about it. But again, e-teasing is a very normal issue in which becomes a lot of bigger fights, right? And how near malls, near colleges, near schools, how this Romeo Squad is placed. Technology, Dial 100 was going on from previous government, how advancements are made in that. How in the starting 1 or 2 months, all the dreaded criminals, right? Who were tadipar, who were FIR'd but never jailed, who ran from the courtrooms and nobody arrested them. Like they were FIR'd, they ran from the courtroom and people know where they're living, but nobody arrested them, right? All such 2,000, 3,000 people were forced to even surrender or do a date with the God, right? And now people like Mukhtar Ansari, people like all such dreaded criminals who are walking in the corridors of parliament or who are walking in the corridors of assembly, now they're illegally occupied properties getting confiscated and they are running for their life, right? So, you know, what is the biggest, and I tell everyone, if you want to follow the status of law and order in any state, one is you'll go NCRB data when it'll come, but see, is the money coming back there? So when you see a 5 lakh crore investment promise comes in the first year and almost 30-40% already started, how a company like Paytm, which is in Noida, but never delivered in Noida before 2017, started delivering even cash on delivery, because now people are moving their companies to Lucknow even, right? And various other parts of UP, because now they saw their money safe, their employees are safe, right? So yeah, law and order is a challenging situation in UP. But see, earlier there's a philosophy on which UP government was running, right? And we all know that ladke hain galti ho jati hai. Ladke hain galti abhi bhi hoti hai, but now they go to jail. Within 4 days, 5 days, they travel to jail, right? You keep hearing a lot of cases here and there, which is I call a doorstep reporting, because the whole of media is in Noida. But a similar or even a graver issue in Kerala is not an issue for some reason in 9 o'clock news. A similar or graver issue in West Bengal is not an issue in 9 o'clock news. But even a smaller issue, I normally say no issue, smaller issue, bigger issue. But UP get extra lens, right? Because of Yogi saffron rope, as I told you. Anti-yogism is an industry for media, but again, law and order is improving, and the way industry is coming back with confidence to UP, and that's a big signal for the positive law and order.
Absolutely, Shantanuji, and I think, like you said, economic growth in UP, in fact, historically, if we look at it, it has been severely affected by a bad law and order situation, and now we see a sea change of difference. But I want to actually go to some of the other things also that have been undertaken by the Yogi Adityanath government. And it doesn't stop just at improving law and order, because we see very active, proactive sort of initiatives to boost industrialization in UP. We see a lot of initiatives to boost livelihood opportunities for people, as well as even improving the state's finances. So can you tell us about these initiatives?
So I think very many, the list is long. I'll give you 3-4 very prominent ones. So as I told you in the very first year, he organized an investment summit where the who's who of industry and even the MSME came, and a 5 lakh crore rupees investment was promised. And that amount is equal to the yearly budget of Uttar Pradesh, by the way, right? And many of these 30-40% of this already done their Bhumi Pujan groundbreaking ceremony. So they're started, they're not the written promises we used to happen in Akhilesh Yadav time, right? So that's happening, that big industry is coming. Noida, Greater Noida, Yamuna Expressway, right? The Jewar Airport puzzle, which was solving on because of the double engine ki sarkar that we keep telling, Narendra Modi at the center, Yogi Adityanath, that land got cleared. Finally, that airport is coming up, allocated to Swiss AG, and that's happening. That's already giving a huge boost to the lot of industries coming in that area, right? Point number two, as I told you recently, film cities coming up in Greater Noida, and that's a whole ecosystem. It's not only someone will come, a lot of people will start living, cameraman, hotels, it will add to a whole industry. Within a decade, you will see a different economy emerging out of the film city and surrounding, right? Now coming to the MSME and smaller sector, the very, very innovative scheme called ODOP, one district, one product. We all know Aligarh ke Taale, right? The locks of Aligarh. We all know the Badohi ke Kalin, Banaras ke Kalin, the carpets from Banaras and Badohi, right? So every district of UP, so UP was an industrial town, right? Three, four decades back. In fact, Kanpur was considered the Manchester of the Uttar Pradesh or Manchester of India, right? So now they're trying to identify what is this one thing or two thing which is very, very known in that state. And there are a lot of artisans, a lot of people who are very deft in that particular art, right? Or that particular object or that particular service, right? So they're giving special promotion through it. They are giving a lot of ODOP melas in Delhi, in Lucknow. When NRI summit happened in Kashi last year, the huge ODOP pandal was there and a lot of people did a lot of buying, selling there, right? Very innovative scheme. Again, coming to state revenues, UP transport department was in losses from various years, finally is booking profit. Right, excise department, the way the allotment was done was very, very, very weak. Now, very strong excise duty process, and revenues are adding to the coffers. Right, and whenever if the UP team, Yogi Adityanath's team, hear any company want to move out within India, so there's a very positive competition within India or from outside, China being a particular. They are rolling a red carpet, right, based on incentives, giving land at lesser cost. Or whatever facilitation they need, right? There's something called Udyog Bandhu through which you can get all the licenses done very easily, right? So again, Yogi Adityanath is simultaneously solving the hygiene problem, right? Like come to office at 9 o'clock type problem, right? Law and order, which was very bad, ladke hain galti ho jati hai types problem, to a very high-ended thing like bringing a film city, making sure Jewar Airport gets done on time, and making sure even a Chinese company, a company which is in China wants to move out, lands in Noida, Greater Noida, the industrial area, right? So I think working on various facets at the same time. So I think, yeah, very good for UP.
Right, absolutely. And I hope there are more good things lined up in the years to come as well. Shantanuji, I want to shift focus slightly and talk about your other book, your recent one, which is the Bharatiya Janata Party, Past, Present and Future. And I want to start with the past part of it. When we talk about BJP, the general, the view or like some of the perception is that the party really began its political journey when the party was formed. But you've argued in your book, and you show it very beautifully, is that BJP is actually a culmination of a various political and ideological movements that date back many previous decades. So can you tell us about the origins of BJP and what is the legacy on which it was formed?
Right. So in fact, one of the taglines of my book on the page is also the story of our world's largest political party, right? And why I say a story, and you rightly pointed out that I don't call BJP a party which is formed in 1980. But technically, for a GK question, upon a kaun banega crorepati question, it's fine. It's formed in 1980, but that's just a semantic, right? Why I say so, and in fact, my book is a 400-page book, right? Only 150 pages are BJP, right? The today's BJP in the name BJP, right? And the rest 250 pages are the history of BJP. Right, so I call it, as you said, BJP is the latest political manifestation of years of nationalistic movement, right? And at least very concretely, whatever happened after 1857, and you can see a lot of debates of today. So let's say a lot of save the cow debates come from the Arya Samaj movements of saving the cow, right? A lot of conversion debates, conversion, reconversion debates have come from the Hindu Mahasabha's time, right? And anyway, Bharatiya Janata Party was Bharatiya Jan Sangh, which was formed in 1951 by Shyama Prasad Mukherjee. They just got merged in Janata Party for 3 years and then they came back And Atal Bihari Vajpayee was in Bhartiya Janasangh. Shyam Prasad Mukherjee was in Hindu Mahasabha. And Hindu Mahasabha was formed by Arya Samajis, right? So at least you can track from Arya Samajis. Though the BJP of today taken the goods from good ideas from all of them. In the governance side, so let's say even Shyam Prasad Mukherjee used to call out that centralized planning, such centralized planning should not be done. It should be decentralized planning. And when Narendra Modi government came, they dissolved the planning commission and formed a consultative Niti Aayog kind of think tank, right? But the idea was coming from 1951's times, right? So that's why I'm saying, so that's a history is continuous. And that's why I'm trying to say that this book is not only the history of BJP. This is also a history of almost 150, 160 years of history of India from a nationalistic point of view, because the whole Academy of India under Jawaharlal Nehru and then Indira Gandhi and led by JNU is so left-leaning that India's history, and so is the BJP's history, whenever written in whichever format, is written in a very different lens. So that's why, if I can also promote my book, this is not only a history of BJP, this is a nationalistic history of India also from the last 150 years.
Absolutely, Shantanuji. And if we have to come to BJP today, well, any observer of politics, both nationally or internationally, has really observed and seen the way BJP has succeeded. I mean, election after election, it has registered really, spectacular election victories. And it has a very broad-based acceptance in Indian society as well, from various sections of the society. So when you look at the BJP and when you compare it with its competitors in India's political landscape, what do you see in BJP that makes it stand out? You know, that probably leads to its successes.
I think two or three things. I think I come from a corporate background. I call it my previous life, right? Before coming to public life. So let me analyze it like a corporate. So in corporate, one of the important things is HR, the human resource. What is the human resource of BJP, right? JP Nadda is not the son, daughter, father, mother of Amit Shah. Amit Shah is not the brother, father, son of Narendra Modi. So is not the relationship between him and Rajnath Singh and any of the BJP's president, right? So you are there as a BJP president because of sheer merit, nothing else. Compared to Congress, is just a musical chair between Sonia Gandhi, Rahul Gandhi, maybe Priyanka Vadra, maybe Robert Vadra, maybe two children of Robert Vadra. These five people will be just doing musical chair. I think 1 year back when they lost the election in 2019, Rahul Gandhi said, no, I want to take the responsibility, I'll have to leave. And then we got an interim president. And who was the interim president? Sonia Gandhi. And Sonia Gandhi is interim from last 1.5 years. Interim is not, they're changing the meaning of the word interim, right? And now there are talks that Rahul Gandhi will be back, right? This is a joke, right? So if I'm the HR head of Congress, my talent pool to choose my CEO is only three people, right? So three people is not a talent pool. In BJP, the talent pool is huge. No one knew who Manohar Khattar was. No one knew who Raghuvar Das was. But because they were able administrators, because they were liked by people, because they've shown their merit, because they've won electorally multiple times, that's why they're there, right? And BJP went against the caste combination of that state. Manohar Lal Khattar is not a Jat, right? Devendra Fadnavis is not a Maratha. Raghuvar Das is not a tribal, right? So I think because the whole of the political language is said that you have to cater to whatever is your vote bank of that state, right? If it's an able administrator, not able administrator, that's a different thing. That we don't want, right? Because we want to have power just for the heck of it, right? That's the way governments were run, right? So if I call the BJP 2.0, and the Narendra Modi and Amit Shah took all of those challenges. And Narendra Modi himself, when BJP put him as a prime minister candidate in 2014, Kamal, if I can say it, he was almost a third level leader in the ranks, right? It was Alke Advani and Murli Manohar Joshi at the top. And then who were the leader of opposition in the house? Sushma Swaraj and Arun Jaitley ji. Unfortunately, both of them are not with us today. And then the chief ministers. But because the whole Sangh Parivar, whole Vichar Parivar identified that this is the person who has the popularity, who has the shared governance experience of 3 terms as a chief minister, can be good for the country, right? And then he was like upspring and he was made the... So this, I think, love for meritocracy is what is making BJP fly. And this is my warning to BJP also. If this system dies in BJP, they will become another Congress, right? Which luckily is not dying. People are saying, oh, Gujarat lobby has captured BJP, but now there is a comparison of Himachal who has become a head. And if you remember after Bihar election, how very eloquently and very gracefully Narendra Modi from stage said, JP Nadda, tum aage badho, hum tumhare saath hai. And JP Nadda, humare leader hai. A leader of stature of Narendra Modi is making sure that the authority of JP Nadda is established very smartly. Right? And all the leaders, on the very senior leaders on the stage, from Nitin Gadkari ji to Rajnath Singh ji to Santosh ji, they all stood and clapped and congratulated him. That's the way you, like, he was a leader in its own merit anyways. He's like a long-standing politician. Last four decades, JP Nadda is. But how you establish it in for your team, that's also important. I think this is the major thing on the human HR side. Now, on what you're working on, your thematic areas, right? Let's say Ram Mandir issue, let's say pro Hindutva issue. They're part of their manifestos from the Palampur Adhivation, the Mandir movement, right? And maybe the cow thing, maybe the 370 thing, maybe the Kashmir resolution, they never dropped it. Lot of time they faced a flag because of that. They gained political power, but they lost political power because of that. But they never left their issues. But this is Rahul Gandhi. Sometimes he says Ram is imaginary. All of a sudden Ram Mandir comes, he said, oh, Ram is everything. Earlier they said Jallikattu should be avoided. Today he's attending a Jallikattu event. So I think he's just a politician of convenience, right? That's point number. How they have one principle, they do it, they put it in their manifesto and they implement it, right? Now people saying, oh, how they remove 370? Amit Shah replied, we are writing that in our manifesto in the last 20 years. In fact, we got late in implementing it, right? Third thing, how hardworking the whole cadre is. And I'll give you an example and that will communicate it. In 2017 or 18, Kamal, I'm forgetting the exact date, Rahul Gandhi was in one of the University of Berkeley in US, and he was giving a lecture and he was defending dynasty there, that India runs on dynasty. Like from Amitabh Bachchan, from a cricketer, he was just giving various examples that I'm not an exception. Like there are people from other walks of life also, that's the way India runs. And the very same day, Kamal, Amit Shah was sitting in 2017 in the house of a karyakarta in West Bengal, where they have no base. And 2019, they won 40% vote share in 18 Lok Sabha seats in a bastion of Mamata Banerjee, right? I went to UP, met the Sangathan Mantri Sunil Bansal ji there 3-4 weeks back in Uttar Pradesh. He's preparing the poll level team for 2022 election sitting today, when there is no election in UP like in the next 1.5 year, right? So in Hyderabad municipal election, the whole of the big machinery was deployed and they made wins. So even if they lose the election, they win the election, they do it everything full heartedly, right? Like it's not the bunch of people who are flirting with politics. Like Rahul Gandhi, kisi din aa gaye, kisi din chale gaye, Saturday you go somewhere in the heat of the moment. You are in London, you are in Bangkok, nobody knows where are you. Your attendance in the parliament is 40-50%. You have hardly asked 10 questions. Your participation in debate is 7-8 debates. Like this is Rahul Gandhi is, right? So let alone I agree with Rahul Gandhi, I disagree. At least you have to match the hard work to the hard work, right? The hard work of Amit Shah, hard work of Yogi Adityanath, hard work of Narendra Modi, you have to match that, right? Otherwise you are just like a part-time politician, right? So these three things, I think makes BJP stand out. And if someone can imitate that, I think they can also be in loved by the people.
Very interesting, Shantanuji. I think public service, one thing that comes out very clearly is that public service is a full-time thing, not yes. something that's...
Yes, not you part-time. You can't do it.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Shantanuji, if I could go a bit deeper on one of the things that you said, and that is, you know, the youth, leadership, but particularly youth, right? So I wanted to understand from you, how does youth also, you know, fit into this, this big sort of a political landscape, particularly from the BJP's point of view? How is the, you know, identification of talent, and how is organic leadership sort of developed? How does that happen?
See, we keep hearing this statement, BJP is a cadre-based party. BJP is a cadre-based party. What does a cadre mean, right? So everyone has some cadre. Right? It's not that Samajwadi Party doesn't have a cadre. What does it exactly mean? See, BJP is a part of a larger vichar parivar that everyone understands, right? And Sangh being at the ideological head of it, right? So if you go and ask a Bharatiya Janata Yuva Morcha person who's doing Maliya Jhanda Yatra, right? BJP keep doing a lot of these events to keep its cadre motivated. You will ask why you're doing it, right? They will say, my love for my country. If you ask an NSUI guy, he will not have no answer. He will say, maybe because I get the petrol for my bike, or maybe because I'll get a chicken plate in the evening, right? That's the motivation, which is fine. I'm not pointing that person out, right? But again, there is no larger narrative to it. So, and in BJP, every position is taken very seriously. So if Narendra Modi today lands in Noida, the Gautam Budh Nagar district president will greet him. And that photo will come in the media tomorrow. The Kshetriya Adhyaksh, which is a very young guy, Mohit Benival, will greet Narendra Modi, right? So every position from Kshetriya Adhyaksh to Jilla Adhyaksh to Mandal Adhyaksh has this seriousness and gravity to it. They're just not made because has to be made. In a lot of those parties, these positions are charted out just 6 months before the elections. So, Sir Kamal, so let's say this BJP is the national team, then there are a lot of morchas. So let's say this Yuva Morcha, Bharatiya Janata Yuva Morcha, BJYM, right? And how this Yuva Morcha is not just a sidey body, the lot of leaders of Yuva Morcha who are in national politics today. Shivraj Singh Chauhan, Dharmendra Pradhan, Kishan Reddy, and there various names. Similarly in the state, Swatandev Singh, today is the BJP party head in UP, right? Now Tejasvi Surya, such a young boy, 29 years old, amazing speaker, understand what he's doing, from Bangalore South, given the ticket, and he won, and now he's addressing the parliament, he's making his constituency, and now roaming around in Bihar to West Bengal to make the party. And that's why a karyakarta in BJP can think that I can be Tejasvi Surya tomorrow. I can be JP Nadda tomorrow. I can be Amit Shah, Narendra Modi tomorrow, because these all guys are not airdropped from anywhere. They all came from some party position, from Mandal Adhyaksh to, and Amit Shah keeps saying that I started by pasting posters on the wall, right? I did not become the Amit Shah of today, all of a sudden, one day, right? So I think that's the meritocracy, which I told in the main party, that's happening in Yuva Morcha also. These morchas are very vibrant morchas, and parties making sure the same node structure, which is there at the center, which goes in all the morchas and travel to the state, to the district, to the mandal, to the booth, right? So this robust party machinery and this love for merit and love for young blood is making the BJP vibrant. And that's why a lot of these young people keep getting good posts, be it Yuva Morcha president or chief ministers or MLAs or MLCs, right? I think which is picking, making the party float.
Absolutely. Very, very fascinating, Shantanuji. I think we have delved into many, many subjects, and thank you so much for sharing those insights with us. It has been a very fascinating conversation, and I'm sure our viewers have much to think about. Thank you so much, Shantanuji, for sharing all that.
Thank you, Kamal. Thanks a lot. Thank you for having me.
Thank you, Shantanuji. And to our viewers, I would like to request you to continue supporting us. Please do subscribe to both our channels, The Festival of Bharat and Chitti Media. And we'll be back with another such fascinating conversation. Until then, take care and stay safe. Namaste.
Namaste. We hope you enjoyed this Chitti Media content. Please remember to subscribe to us and switch on the notifications for this channel. For our other social media links, more content, and to support our work, please visit citti.net. Dhanyavaad. Namaskar.